During my formative teenage years, I developed a strong affinity towards bands like Devo, Kraftwerk, and Ultravox. Specifically, the music these bands released from around the 1970s through to about 1984. I'd initially become interested in these bands due to their early and innovative use of analog synths, but something changed around 1984. These artists whose catalogs I'd listened through endlessly hit a wall, past which all music they released was kind of awful, occasionally alright, but mostly just awful. And I couldn't understand why initially, but as I learned more about the introduction of the DX7 in 1983 and other forms of digital and sampling synths, it all started to make sense. These bands had been led astray by the dark forces of digital synthesis. I was getting into music production and synthesis at the stage I was discovering this, and this conclusion I'd reached solidified my path towards analog synthesis. On some level, I recognized that digital synthesis must have some validity, but my historical references indicated that the allure of digital was not to be trusted. The thing is, sincerely resisting digital synthesis in the modern age takes a serious amount of rationalization and mental gymnastics, and that's what we're going to be unpacking in this video. Many aspects of analog and digital are quite different, from the quality, artifacts, aesthetics, and workflow. I grew up in the age of the MP3. Within my family when I was a child, we had a few iPods come and go over the years. I distinctly recall a first-gen iPod Shuffle, an iPod Nano, and an iPod Video. I don't recall exactly when these devices came into the home, but their use was distributed amongst myself and my sister, and our parents as well, but It was mostly myself and my sister that were using these things. I'd have the iPod Shuffle whilst my sister had the Nano, but when she got the Video, I got the Nano, and on it went. We had CDs around, but even at that time, I considered them as limited novelty items. Music could be retrieved from them to put onto the computer, and then the iPod. Making copies of CDs was fun, but ultimately pointless, since any utility gained was overshadowed by the presence of an iPod. Eventually, CDs became redundant even as music retrieval mechanisms, as you could give the iTunes people money to download music without ever needing to go to a physical store. At some point, I became aware of LimeWire, Pirate Bay, etc., and money was no longer a limiting factor even in the acquisition of music or any other media. The limitations became hard drive space and internet download capacity. And since I was downloading movies and TV shows as well as music, I regularly found myself pressed up against those limits. I think 250 gigabytes was a normal amount of storage for a computer, possibly even less, and we'd have 10 gigabytes total downloads for a month. I remember later on it being upgraded to 100 gigabytes a month and still blowing through it. It was in this context that I discovered cassette tapes, VHS, and vinyl. These were archaic forms, but they held a strange appeal. They were mechanically elaborate and inherently limited, but that's what I found appealing about them. In a world where digital information was immediately accessible, where movies and music can be retrieved with minimal effort from the collective database of all human knowledge, it's exciting to engage in a medium that's so inherently limited. You can't just press a button on a computer and copy a cassette. You need two machines, one capable of recording, one capable of playback, and without specialized equipment, you can only bounce the information across in real time, and you lose quality in the process. I can recall instances where I'd need to be on my way somewhere, but really wanted to listen to some album I'd just downloaded. I'd begin the transfer of the songs to my iPod and watch with impatience as it took a whole minute to copy an hour's worth of music. At various times I tried, as an experiment, listening to music only through cassettes, and this had interesting results. I had to interact with the medium of cassettes entirely differently than I did with the iPod. Which of the albums did I want to bring with me? Bringing more than one would be cumbersome, so what album was I going to listen to? I got into making mixtapes, sometimes even putting whole podcast episodes onto a tape. It was fun, but since the transfers were real time, I'd have to prepare it in advance, which means I'd need to begin really thinking about it in advance. Being forced to find a new relationship to music and my developing musical tastes was thrilling, and deeply engaging, far more so than the instant gratification provided by MP3s. Listening to music on my Walkman and realizing I hadn't successfully anticipated my own tastes resulted in me becoming more considerate about how I constructed playlists for myself in the future. Certain songs and moods flow well together and others don't. There are many intricacies to creating a good playlist, and the medium of cassettes really forced me to think about it. On-the-fly playlist curation is safe in this regard in a way I never considered consciously until I had printed that playlist into a physical medium and was stuck with that order, having to haphazardly fast forward to the next track, which hopefully fit my current mood better. This exact experience and relationship to music is barely possible with an iPod, and even less possible with modern phones and our ability to stream anything with literally no forethought required. In many ways, this technological improvement has been a good thing, but something has been lost. something subtle and possibly arbitrary, something that if we don't understand and consider, will be forgotten to time. Digital has opened up a world of infinities, a world which asks less of us and caters better to our whims. When I began making music, due to my healthy fixation with Devo, Ultravox, Kraftwerk, and other bands from the pre-digital period that heavily featured analog synths, I'd set myself the requirement of only using analog synthesizers. In part, it was because they genuinely sound really good, and I want my music to sound good, but the main factor that weighed heavily in that decision is that since digital was what ruined these bands, I wasn't going to be making those same mistakes. This was admittedly an expensive decision. When all my friends were getting Xboxes and PlayStations for Christmas, I was getting the Arturia Microbrew. These days, when my friends are spending money on travel and vacations, I'm staying home and buying a Matrix Brew. Luckily, a lot of other people must have been going through a similar obsession with analog at about the exact same time I was, as companies that hadn't released analog synths in decades were re-entering the analog synth market. In my rejection of digital synthesis, I needed to employ a lot of mental gymnastics to resist virtual analog synths. Anyone with a computer can use plug-in synths. It's software, information, lines of code which can be copied and replicated infinitely. Even digital hardware synths are just lines of code running on a computer with a keyboard and a user interface attached. Regardless of how simple or challenging it is in practice to copy or download a digital synthesizer due to artificial copy prevention methods, on a deep level, it's all just lines of code. It's just information. In that sense, it's ephemeral. It holds no tangible existence beyond its status as information. Now, information is great. Don't get me wrong. Having access to the sum totality of all human knowledge in the palm of one's hand is a massive selling point for living in the modern age. But this only serves to make analog hardware seem more valuable due to its physicality, the inherent costs involved in production, and the fact that you can't just copy and paste infinite versions of them. I did end up using some of the free digital recreations of old analog synths for compositional purposes, but in order to meet the true analog standard I'd set myself and hold myself to even to this day, every bit of recorded audio that ended up in a final mix had to be produced from real analog circuitry. I was cultishly committed to analog synthesis. An interesting side effect of this level of puritanism within my approach towards music production is that my process takes way longer than it needs to. With digital plug-in synths that arguably sound just as good, if not better, any change or tweak to a sound or the notes can be done with a few alterations to the MIDI. Add in a couple of extra automation points, make this note longer, put that note into the correct key, etc. And that's it. Then you mix it, hit publish, and move on with your life. With an analog workflow, each time you want to make changes to a recorded track, you need to re-record the entire track. I mean, yes, you could just re-record the changed section, but you'd lose some of the arbitrary analog magic. Since there's random variation in how analog operates, you can't really drop in as trying to realign all LFOs and other complex elements to how they were on the part being fixed. It becomes too much of a chore, and it's just straight up easier to re-record that entire part again. But this level of arbitrary difficulty really forces you to interact with the technology in a very deliberate manner. It brings me back to the same headspace as when I was creating cassette mixtapes for myself, trying to anticipate what I would or wouldn't feel like listening to in the future. The extra time and precision it requires from you, the benefits of getting it right, and the time and energy penalties for getting it wrong, this taught me a lot and has become an invaluable part of my process. Not taking shortcuts forces a relationship to the music and the craft that rewards becoming hyper-conscious of how things are working, and hyper-conscious in a way that allows me to create pieces that I'm genuinely proud of. But is it true, as I believed for so long, that analog is of fundamental importance to the production of good electronic music? This is an assumption I didn't really question too much until I began working in a music studio. My mentor, David Pendragon, grew up in the pre-digital era. He was there for the introduction of digital technology and made the transition along with the whole rest of the recording industry from analog to digital. Along with my romanticized notions towards analog synthesis, I was fascinated by tape as a recording medium. My goal was at some point to be able to record my analog synths onto tape rather than digitally. The expenses involved in doing this are prohibitive enough that I was willing to accept digital recording as acceptable, but as a less than preferable option. To mix in the box is fine, if you have to, but to have a tape recording mixed entirely on outboard gear would be the ideal. My mentor, David, having come from the period of time where this ideal wasn't an ideal, and in fact was a mandatory fact of reality, was very confused by my perspective. In his way of seeing things, analog was so limited that the move towards digital was a blessing. Analog recording had so many downsides and practical limitations that he struggled to comprehend why anyone would want to give up digital for it. Recording as a sound engineer in those days was an endless struggle to eliminate noise in order to get the cleanest, highest quality recordings possible. It was a constant battle which required juggling many moving parts, from keeping the machines correctly aligned and maintained to highly precise gain staging and deliberate use of compression and EQ on the way in, to not listening back to a recording too many times in order to not wear out the tape. All of these technical considerations had to be made just to deal with the noise, taking up a lot of time and energy, all before moving on to any of the more subjective and creative production level decisions. Now, the introduction of digital recording radically changed things. Instead of spending inordinate amounts of time and energy to keep the recordings clean and noise-free, they were now clean and noise-free by default. You could play a track as many times as you liked without it changing at all. The thing that became clear to me is that my ability to romanticize the past and analog technology was facilitated by the digital technology that I grew up with and am immersed within. Being forced to work within a highly limited set of constraints is completely different from choosing to work within those constraints. This really becomes a matter of process and workflow. The thing is, even though I place analog synthesis above all other forms of synthesis, my process for recording and composing is almost entirely digital. I compose almost exclusively inside of a DAW, and when I record the digitally composed parts through my analog synths, they're recorded back into a DAW and then mixed and mastered within a DAW. My mentor also pushed me to consider the difference in sound quality between analog and digital, from plugins and their physical counterparts to analog synths and their digital emulations. I'd believed that analog's magic was something that couldn't be replicated by digital processes. It took a while for me to accept that the difference in sound from an analog device to its digital replication was often basically nil. And even when it wasn't nil, the development and improvement of digital technology is getting to a place where the gap is closing in. So I moved past my desire for analog outboard gear and tape recording. Not only is it impractical, but it's expensive and I can't afford it. So I've already committed myself to an analog path, and I'm very happy to stay on this path, but I realized that good music doesn't come from using an analog synth over a digital synth, or from using hardware over software. This is an inescapable conclusion once you accept, as I have, that analog synths can be replicated digitally. The thing which makes a piece of music good and valid comes down to far less arbitrary variables, such as how you use the tools you have access to and how you set limitations for yourself to work within. According to the laws of mathematics, there's a limited amount of music that can exist. It's a really large amount of music, more than humans might ever reasonably produce, but there is technically a limited amount of music that can exist. Once you take every note and every possible relationship it can have to every other note and every possible sequence of notes against every other sequence and et cetera, you can calculate a finite number. It's an incredibly large number, but technically it's possible, given enough time and culture, to finish music, to have all of it. Okay, sorry, I've been lying to you right now. We've already done it. All 68.7 billion melodies have been printed to a hard drive and copyrighted. So what now? We're done, right? Musicians can finally go off and find a way to make themselves useful, right? Okay, obviously that's never going to happen. But with this context, the task of the musician looks a bit different. A musician's job isn't to come up with new melodies, as all melodies already technically exist. The job is to sort through them, to find the best ones, the ones that resonate, and to share them, to explore the space of all possible music with the tools available, in search of interesting stuff, uncovering relative novelty, and that which resonates and connects, finding the arrangement of notes and timbres that makes you and others feel something. It doesn't matter what those tools are, as long as you're able to use them to dig deeper, create more, and bring it back to share with the world. A notion I find useful in all of this is Platonic idealism. Also, the muse. The way I conceive of both of these, they work together in tandem. Just in case you're not familiar with these, Platonic idealism is the idea that outside of our physical reality is a reality of forms which is projected into our reality. But it's done imperfectly, as our reality is limited in ways that true forms aren't. The muse is a personified, angel-like figure that visits artists and gives them inspiration. I find these ideas useful for creating music as well as creating in other mediums such as writing and doing visual stuff. As a teenager, I became obsessed with rotoscope animation. Then, when in my media class we could choose our own projects, I decided to make my own rotoscope animation. I filmed a short video, edited it, reduced the frame rate to about 12 FPS, then over a period of at least a month, I'd spend every evening hand tracing each individual frame. I placed a piece of paper up against the image, traced it, advanced the video to the next frame, and repeated until done. When played back, many of the details of the original video had been lost, but the underlying essence was preserved. Some degree of intuitively recognizable motion and shape had carried across, although almost all resolution and quality and detail was lost from the image. To this day, when making music or writing stories, creating art in any capacity, I get a sense of familiarity. On some level, I'm brought back to the notion that all I'm doing is tracing something that already exists as a complete form elsewhere. Oftentimes it really feels like that, as if all I'm doing is listening to music, which is already there, and just transcribing it into our physical plane of existence. In order to enter the state where I'm best able to tune into the art which is already there, I need to engage in rituals that I conceptualize of as appeasing the muse, creating the conditions necessary for it to arise. These conditions will be different for different people, but learning how to tune into it is essential for artists. The main condition I've found that needs to be satisfied, though, in order for the muse to arise, is willingness to put in the work. If the muse knows it has access to your time and energy, it'll show up and bring you these forms that you can transcribe into our world through your chosen medium. Once music is an infinite space to be explored, the platonic ideal for the piece of music you're creating exists somewhere, buried within the space, and the muse becomes the guide for locating it. In choosing analog over digital, prioritizing physical reality over the intangible software, it feels like one path through the space of music. Different tools illuminate different aspects of the musical space, and different tools used in various arrangements will open up whole other areas of the musical space. Analog presents a certain set of limitations which can be useful for excavating certain areas and can be less useful for excavating others. In this regard, our tools determine the music that can be made or found with them, but is analog really all that different in this regard to digital? Okay, so, well, yes, but also no. I don't think these differences are actually all that important. Analog works for me, but digital works for many other people. The thing is, bad music can be produced on anything, even analog synths, and there's plenty of good music which is made with digital synths. So, sure, there might be some differences, but I don't think it's fair to claim one tool is superior to another because they're different. I believed in the capacity of analog synthesizers as a tool for exploring the space of music, and therefore was able to find ways in which I can use them to do that. In the 1980s, digital synthesis was introduced, and at almost the exact same time, the bands I loved that had used analog synths switched over to digital and dropped immensely in quality. For a long time, I blamed digital synthesis for this, but the subsequent analysis I've done in recent years based on information I've learned since bears out more nuanced results. These bands seem to have suffered from a series of issues relating to internal and external pressures. The introduction of digital synthesis may have been a factor in pushing them over the edge, but I no longer think it's fair to say that digital synthesis is the demonic force I'd conceived it as for so many years. Digital is quite different to analog. These bands went from using analog synths, tools they'd put years of practice towards, which had played a large role in their musical identity, to then picking up an entirely new tool and trying to be innovative with it. They took a risk, and there's something to be admired in that, even if the results create a hard line in their catalog beyond which I will not listen. Plenty of music, including good music, is produced with the use of digital synthesis. It's just a tool. These tools aren't magic, they are just tools. It's how you use them that counts. Whilst my irrational obsession with analog synthesizers might in retrospect be grounded in some highly suspect logic, I do value the workflow it's imposed on my productions and the aspects of sound it forces me to consider and engage with. So I actually ended up leaving a digital sound in one of the tracks on my band Cyberspace Oblivion's first album. I just couldn't get any of my analog synths to sound as good as the digital synth sounded, so I left it in. I was nearly finished with the mixes and had committed to releasing it and was kind of just done with the project and ready to move on to the next thing. So I left the digital sound in and moved on to the next thing. I won't lie, it still somewhat bugs me, but I know that part of the reason I left it in was as an act of exposure therapy. If I can accept this piece of work despite the presence of a digital synthesizer, maybe that represents some form of progress or growth. I don't know. Anyways, if you enjoyed the video and would like to access bonus content and have your name featured at the end of future videos, sign up to my Patreon. Also, if you like analog synth music, go check out my band, Cyberspace Oblivion. Okay, bye. Goodbye.